Let's prepare our hearts for a fresh start.
I've been working hard so long. Seems like pain has been my only friend. My fragile heart's been done so wrong. I wondered if I'd ever heal again. Just like all the seasons never stay the same. All around me I can feel the change.
Yeah. Join me for the welcoming words. Shalom.
Shalom.
Salam.
Salam.
Namaste.
Namaste.
Peace.
Friends, I'm going to have a conversation today with someone who is quite familiar in one context here. But I want to introduce you to Michael Clark, who doesn't only play the guitar. You do some other things as well.
Yeah, I try to.
What do you do?
Well, I've got an art show going on right now.
Get out of town.
Yeah.
Really?
What a concept, right?
Yeah.
The Storefront Indie Theater down at 62nd and College. I've got my, today's the last day of my art show. It's 2 to 8. And so a lot of you people from the garden last night showed up.
It's a beautiful.
Thank you.
It's a beautiful space, and yep, your work is positively beautiful. Is there a name for the style of work you do?
Well, I just call it, abstract mixed media.
It's really
that
beautiful.
Kind of thing.
Very vibrant.
Yeah. Well, I was influenced by a lot of the 60s rock posters.
Just the posters, right? Nothing else.
No. I don't know what you're talking about, Carol. What's that all about?
I pray for your soul every day, Michael. No, not really.
Okay, where was I?
You're being inspired by art.
Yeah.
Posters of the 1960s.
Yeah, that kind of real bright, that kind of real improvised look. And, you know, I consider my art like improvising on my music and instruments. You know, I just start with something and it ends up totally different than what it comes out on. So it's all kind of, you know, real expressionistic. And, you know, I don't do portraits or anything like that. But it's, you know, kind of a more of a graphic, you know, approach to abstract painting, and it's all started on my computer, and then I print it out, and then I paint and draw over the top of it, and then it's finished, basically. So, but I want to thank Carolyn and Andrew.
Really?
They've been great supporters of me.
Oh, well.
They really have. And the garden, too. But they have. They've been real, real, real nice, you know, so I really appreciate it.
Well, we love your art, and someday my house will be done, and I'll invite all these people over to see the pieces that we have.
Can we have high tea?
We can have a high tea. Yes, we can. Yes.
Yeah, you know, but I want to do
because you're such a high tea kind of guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I look like.
So last night when I got home, you know, the microphone, just put sold on it, but don't tell him. All right. So.
Hey, you
oh, never. All right. Michael, thank you, for not only making this world more beautiful with your beautiful music, but the artwork is stunning. A number of gardeners came out last night, and it was so much fun to be together. If you didn't make it there, I encourage you to do so. Do not let the construction scare you off. There are places to park.
Yeah.
There's places that you can be, but go and take a look at this beautiful artwork. And Michael, God bless you. I really like you. I know that's. I give you such a hard time because I love you. I love you. I love you.
I love you too.
All right. So 2 to 8 today on Broad Ripple Avenue. If you used to hang out at the Vogue, there's parking right back there behind the Vogue. You can go back there, get onto Broad, and then take a little gander around his show. It is quite stunning, pretty exciting. So. We have so much talent in this.
Carolyn, yeah. I forgot to thank Michael Reed for playing.
Yes.
Oh, God. It was fun.
It was good. It was great fun. It was great fun. Michael had his own corner with a big spotlight on him.
My own display.
You had your own display. And somebody asked. Someone asked, how much? No, anyway.
Patty is not selling.
She is not selling. All right. We have so much talent just up here on this stage. This next piece, just as we were blessed with another piece by Michael Reed not long ago, is also a spiritual offering from Michael Reed. The words are in your bulletin. But once again, the Spirit has moved here in this amazing song called Start Again.
Thank you.
Feels like the winter keeps right on rolling. Makes it hard to want to get out of bed. Well, you know it's not gonna last. Now it's time to forget the past. Put your feet down on the path. You gotta get going. Everybody wants a new beginning. Trying to forget what they have done. Something's good, something's bad. Something's made a loved one sad. Just remember that you're not the only one. Just start again. It's not the end. Just start again. It's not the end. You're starting over. Start again. It's not the end. Just start again. It's not the end. You're starting over. Sometimes I think everything falls to pieces, but I'm looking around and I open my eyes. There's a road where there once was none. There's a garden freshly dug. And tomorrow I'll see the sun slowly rising. In the rain I'm walking with my umbrella. Strong wind comes along and blows it away. But the sun comes out to shine. And my clothes are gonna dry. And I'll cross my bridge of sighs in the morning. I start again. It's not the end. I start again. It's not the end. I'm starting over. Let's start again. It's not the end. Let's start again. It's not the end. We're starting over. Try to feel the joyousness of children. Think of all the hills they have to climb. Just look into their eyes and you're gonna realize they need help getting their toes on the starting line. Try to write a song for Sunday morning. Another crumpled paper on the floor. Time for slowly breathing in. Picking up that ballpoint pen. And I'll start to sing this melody once more. Let's start again. It's not the end. Let's start again. It's not the end. We're starting over. Let's start again. It's not the end. Let's start again. It's not the end. We're starting over.
Author William Wordsworth was quoted as saying, "Life is divided into three terms, that which was, which is, and which will be. Let us learn from the past to profit by the present, and from the present to live better in the future." Wonderful words. It reminds me of my favorite Christmas story, Charles Dickens' A Christmas Carol. Ebenezer Scrooge, the hero or villain, depending on your point of view, is offered a chance to change his ways by three Christmas spirits: the ghost of Christmas past, the ghost of Christmas present, and the ghost of Christmas yet to be. He has shown his past and current life, both the good and the bad. He has also shown how the events will transpire if the current path is taken. He is basically given a chance to do a fresh start and change his heart. He is given a fresh start. Springtime is made for fresh starts, as Carolyn's going to tell us all about. We are given a chance to do a fresh start if need be. Every day can be a fresh start. Let us pray. Lord, thank you for the many blessings you give us every day, including the fresh starts you provide us. Thank you for the love and support during these challenging times. Help us to see the path that you would like us to pursue, our yellow brick road, so to speak, so we can reach our full potential. I pray for all the suffering souls in the world that you will heal them from their pain. I pray for our world and local leaders that they will do what's best for humanity. Please help us to have the wisdom and courage to help our fellow human souls through troubled times. Help us to look past our differences and realize we have much more in common than we realize. Show us that you love us, all of us, from the homeless to the rich and powerful and million-dollar mansions. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Dennis. Thank you, Michael. I love that he's like preaching to us every week. It's just so perfect. It's so perfect. Today we're going to look at some lessons from the Bible. I thought it'd be good to try that one. And what's interesting is I've been reading about the ritual of life and how the ritual of life is moving away from the church, but people are finding rituals elsewhere. Do you know the fastest growing sacred community? CrossFit. There's no danger of this pastor taking that over, but isn't that interesting? People are joining CrossFit, and they're making these relationships that are so meaningful to them. I guess there's a whole series of words that goes with it, and people taking care of each other, and it's pretty powerful. That's the fastest growing community of faith. And one of the things that's important about ritual and establishing ritual in our own lives is we have to establish and find sacred text, all right? So for me, the sacred text is the Bible on many levels. First of all, because the union says, the church says, here's your sacred text, right? And that's the one you go to on a regular basis. But I recognize there are lots of sacred texts out there. A sacred text is anything that you turn to again and again to experience a spiritual change. And so I want to encourage you, think about what sacred texts you have in your life. Most often when I preach the Bible here each and every week, I will spend time on a gospel lesson. Well, today we don't have a gospel lesson. We're going to start with an Old Testament lesson from the prophet Isaiah, and then Isaiah said this. He said, forget what happened before and do not think about the past. Look at the new thing I'm doing. It's already happening. Don't you see it? I will make a road in the desert and rivers in dry land. So that's an Old Testament. Now, usually this is where I'll throw in the gospel, but today we're not going to look at the gospel. We're going to talk about a guy. I'll give you his name in a little bit. But we're also going to talk about how he was forever changed by an individual experience. I believe that led him to write this. Everything that we have, right thinking and right living, a clean slate and a fresh start comes from God by way of Jesus Christ. Happy May Day. Do you have any idea what it is? Don't worry, nobody else does either, right? I have looked, and May Day is a tradition celebrated and in some Germanic countries, and it's celebrated in different places. But May Day is traditionally a pagan holiday. How about that? We take most of our holidays from pagan holidays. It's a time of celebration about what creation, that's what the pagans did. They celebrated creation. It was a promise that summer is on the way, a time we witness the earth renewing herself. I mean, come on, have you seen those red buds this year? They're positively stunning. Spring is a season of hope, the rebirth of belief that the goodness of God is alive, and God shows that by making this world green again. It's not that hope can't blossom at any time, but there is something about this weather, about the green grass and the warmth and the pollen-filled days. If you already haven't experienced your allergies, you soon will, because you're in Indiana, you will have allergies someday, I guarantee you. But when the air awakens and the pollen takes off, it's a reminder to us that something's changing. Something's changing. The earth is changing, and the promise of new life and growth is being fulfilled right before our very eyes. As poet Christiana Rossetti put it, there is no time like spring when life's alive in everything. There's no time like spring when life's alive in everything. Hard to believe that just a couple of weeks ago, there was snow on the ground, and now it's spring. Today, folks, we'll gather to play in those 15 raised beds, to refresh the soil after a long, cold winter. Bill will lead this team in planting, and soon that refresh will provide an environment for plants and seeds to grow. And they're not just growing for the sake of growth. Remember that all of that produce, 100% of that produce, goes to Crooked Creek Food Pantry, which feeds people in Pike and Washington townships. And studies show that this year, more than ever, if you've been to the grocery store, it's gonna get worse, not better. People need help. So we need a good harvest, and we need lots of help. We need to get over there today and take those weeds out and really get the soil ready to produce something good. Not only that, love about Eskenazi Picard is we are there, by the way, we lease the property for $1 a year, which I don't think I have ever paid. Anyway, in any case, I don't think they're going to kick us out. In any case, not only can you get fresh produce there that's grown right there, but you can get health care and you can get cared for as well. If you have good health care, you're blessed, I guess that's what they say. But gall darn it, we shouldn't be blessed with health care. We should all have good health care. And because of places like Eskenazi Picard, people who might not have a place to go, you do have a place to go. And that's something that I think we often forget that we need to be outraged about, because we can go get those scans and things like that and pay the copayment or whatever it is. But remember, there are people all throughout this country that cannot do that. And I think it's time for us to get a little outraged about that. But let me get off that soapbox and get back on the fresh one. I'm curious about this renewal. How many of us are ready to spring our lives into new ways of being? Because in many ways, we are no different than creation. We too need a refresh and a renewal for our lives emotionally, mentally, and spiritually. We need to dig into the soil of our own being and see what needs to be in there and nurtured and what needs to be taken out. What weeds need to go? It seems as though this should be natural, but we all know that there are some that are not really able to spring into the future. We get stuck in our ways of being. Even if we aren't all that satisfied with life, what we have is okay. And a fresh start, well, it's optional. In some ways, I think actually the pandemic in the last couple of years has helped with this attitude of, I don't know, apathy. We don't necessarily feel the need to grow and refresh. But some of us, and we know who we are, need a little tilling. We need some new soil exposed so that we can refresh. And it's at times like this that I'm reminded of this guy named Paul, the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul was a man who understood firsthand what it was like to have a dramatic fresh start. In the first part of his life, Paul was known as Saul. And he comes on the scene in the book of Acts, which is part of our sacred text. And in the book of Acts, the 8th chapter, he is giving approval to the death of Stephen, who was a caregiver. Stephen, a caregiver, was stoned to death. If you ever go to the Holy Lands, you will find there. He was stoned to death. Saul said, yeah, I'm good with that. Go ahead and do that. Not only that, but Saul also had murderous threats against the Lord's disciples. That's what the next chapter says in chapter 9 of that sacred text. Saul was a guy who said something and it happened. He said something. People respected him. people believed in him. He was a man with money and wealth. He was educated, and he had a career. And his life was moving in a pretty good direction. He had settled into the community comfortably, and I believe in some ways he was probably heading towards retirement. But then Saul had this dramatic encounter with God where he was literally knocked off his high horse and blinded for 3 days. During his time of darkness, God showed him a new light and granted him a fresh start, a second chance. Not only did God provide that opportunity, but Saul embraced this new life that God had to offer. He stepped out of his comfort zone and into this fresh start. Not only the fresh start, but he wanted to not only have a fresh start personally, but he wanted the world to know that he was different too. So he even changed his name from Saul to Paul and became the Apostle Paul, a missionary, an evangelist, a church planter, a pastor. He is the author of most of the New Testament. He really was a remarkable man who shows us what a fresh start looks like. I'm sure that this fresh start was on his mind when he wrote those words we said earlier. Everything that we have, right thinking and right living, a clean slate and a fresh start comes from God by way of Jesus Christ. Today, as we consider making fresh starts, I want us to look at Paul and think about Paul. Now, as I look out here, I don't think I see anybody who's saying, yeah, go stone your neighbor. I don't think I'm seeing anybody who says, yes, murder to the people I don't like. I don't think that that's really your way of going. But, as I said before, there is something in your life and in my life that we've been blind about. And if given the opportunity, and if we take the time to listen to God, I believe many of us will be knocked off our horses and maybe even struck blind for a few days. By the way, if that happens during communion today, there are people here I know who will help you home if you open yourself to that. And if I do that, I went ahead and put my address in my phone, just somebody take me home. I mean, because sometimes fresh starts are like that. They're dramatic, and they change, and life can change in a minute, on a moment, on a dime, and it is profound when it happens. John Mayer grew up in New York City on the Lower East Side. Is that a singer, too? This is not the singer, all right? He died in 1988, which is probably the day when that singer was born. But in any case, he grew up on the New York Lower East Side. Growing up, he was totally intrigued with Ellis Island. We all know what Ellis Island is, right? It was not far from his home. It's where all the immigrants came through Ellis Island. And then they also often, the first road that they would walk was Delancey Street on the Lower East Side of New York. Now, in the midst of his life, he had this experience as a boy, but his life didn't go the way that most of us picture our lives going. Unlike Michael, who was inspired by those posters, I think this guy was making his own posters. In fact, he became, as a young man, became addicted to drugs and alcohol, and his life completely became overwhelming. But that something happened. He was offered a fresh start, and after years of addiction, he wondered if maybe he might be able to do something for someone else. After years of challenge with having very little or nothing, he wondered if maybe, just maybe, he could make a difference in the world. Now, he was an entrepreneur, but he had also been an entrepreneur in the drug business, and chances of him getting a loan from a bank, well, they were impossible. So John, who had this dramatic shift, went to a loan shark and borrowed $1,000. Now, he lived in San Francisco, and he borrowed this money from a loan shark in San Francisco, and he went into this building that was pretty awful. But he knew four other guys who wanted a fresh start and a dramatic change for their lives as well. And this was in 1971. And on During that time, with that loan and those four guys, this place called Delancey Street started. If you've ever been to San Francisco and you've not been to Delancey Street, you have to go. It's a remarkable place that started with one man's dream that he could have a fresh start greater than his addiction. He believed that his fellow addicts were really like the immigrants of Ellis Island, and that's why he called this Delancey Street. He realized that it didn't matter. They were all races, all ages, all backgrounds. The only thing they had in common is they had reached this place where they were ready for a fresh start. Mayer and his partner, Mimi Silbert, had a dream to develop a new model to help people not necessarily get a handout, but to get a hand up so their lives could be forever changed. And now for over 40 years, Delancey Street has been in existence. This new model helps people turn their lives around. People who were in poverty, substance abuse, former felons, and others who had hit the bottom found a new promise and a fresh start and a problem with a solution for their problem. As I said before, for over 40 years, Delancey Street has been there to provide housing, not only housing, but work training programs and educational opportunities for fresh starts. Delancey Street also is now home to one of the finest restaurants in San Francisco. Anybody been? It is a remarkable place. And in fact, it's on one of those TripAdvisor best places to be. And to just think that this really wonderful restaurant in the heart of New York City is run by people who had some pretty tough backgrounds. Addicts, prisoners, prostitutes. Not only the restaurant, but the stories out of Delancey Street, and I bet if you go online, you can find them. There are stories about people who have become chefs, people who have gone on to open their own restaurants, people who have gone on to be social workers, and yes, even the San Francisco Medical Examiner came through Delancey Street. All because one man believed that God had a better life for him than the one he was living and could offer him a fresh start. Today, we have the opportunity for a fresh start with Holy Communion. I believe in this meal, God can knock you off your high horse if that's what you need and help you to see life in a new way. And I mean that. I mean that if you come to this table sincerely, God will change your life. As you come here today, you may need that kind of change. You may need to be blinded and seeing life and promise in a new and different way, especially as we are witness to what's happening in the world today. Perhaps today, you may not need to be blinded and kicked off your high horse. Maybe you just need a little freshening up of your own personal garden. Yesterday, Andrew and I had the opportunity to spend some time with my aunt and uncle who made a donation to the garden, and we agreed to go do a high tea for them. My aunt is 92. She robbed the cradle. Her husband is 90. And when we pulled up to their home, what I noticed absolutely immediately was how beautiful her yard looked. I mean, those irises that were planted all winter long are coming up with these beautiful purple flowers on them. But not only that, but she freshened up the soil a little bit by planting her own little add-ons, which she informed me are from Costco, and they got a really good deal on those add-ons. She filled her pots up, and her yard looked positively beautiful. Geraniums and daisies and it was just so beautiful. In the midst of our conversation, I realized that my aunt and uncle at 90 and 92 had not only freshened up the garden, but they had clearly started refreshing their lives in new ways as well. My uncle, who was a dean at Butler for many, many years, his eyesight is failing. And instead of letting that take him down to a different place, he's discovered audiobooks that you can get for free at the library. And even better, if you have a hearing aid, you can get it to play right through your hearing aid. I mean, he is just amazed by this. And what he's doing is he's going back to all the books that he read as a boy and being reminded what they're like. And then also what they're like for a man of 90. Yesterday, he was listening to Moby Dick, which I actually heard a little too for his earbud. My Auntie M, at 92, in addition to her investment club and her workouts and her volunteering for PEO and her church work, has become a fan of Wordle. Right? Andrew was beaten, whatever that means, by Auntie M at Wordle yesterday, and quite frankly, he said, she's the best. At 92. So as you come to the communion table today, perhaps you are in need of being kicked off your high horse, but maybe your yard just needs a little freshening up. Maybe you just need to till the soil a little bit and plant some new flowers. But maybe you do need to be blinded and knocked down a peg. No matter where you are on the journey, as I said before, I am sincere when I say that this table provides a new life and a new beginning. Jesus said, share in this meal and you will never hunger nor thirst again. Well, that hunger and that thirst is deeper than physical hunger and thirst. This meal provides an opportunity for you to step out of the ordinary and to step into the extraordinary love of God. I want to encourage you as you're sitting there. Do I need to be knocked off a high horse or blinded for a few days? Or do I just need to freshen up the yard? I don't know where you are on the journey, but guess who does? God knows. God knows what you need on this day, and God will help you on that journey. The biggest problem we have in life is not that God isn't willing to help us. It's us not willing to ask for help. So today, as we come to the communion table, I just want you to think about what's not working. I want you to think about what needs refreshing. And I want you to ask God to help you refresh and have a new beginning on this day. We share in Holy Communion the first Sunday of every month at the Garden. You don't have to be a member of this church or any church. You need only believe in a superpower that can refresh and change your life. All who are here are invited to partake in this feast or in this meal, in this ritual that's part of who we are as a community of faith. It was left to us from some 2,000 years ago by Jesus, who had gathered with his friends for a meal. And after he gathered with his friends for that meal, he took them aside because he always wanted them to remember that he would be with them. So he took bread, and he lifted it to heaven, and he gave thanks to God. Then he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and his friends, and he said, take and eat of this, all of you. This is my body, which is given for you. As often as you eat, remember, you can be forever changed by my love. He also took the cup, which was filled with wine. We use grape juice. He lifted it to heaven, and he gave thanks to God, and he said, take and drink of this, all of you. And to get their attention, perhaps, and because it was a culture of sacrifice, he said, this represents my blood, my body and my blood, which I'm given for you so that you can have a new beginning. That's what we're given. It's a physical reminder of this incredible power that we've been blessed with. Today, I just want you to take a minute and think about what needs refreshing, and then I will lead us in this feast. But before I do so, let us pray. God, we do not presume to come to this your table trusting in our own goodness, but in your unfailing, refreshing mercy. Help us right now to seek your guidance on the journey. Help us to take Jesus into our very being so that we may be made new and refreshed by his life, his death, and his resurrection. Amen. the body of Christ given for you. Take and eat. The blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink. Through the power of the life, death, and resurrection of Jesus, you are forgiven and made new. I'm not blind, but I'm ready for a change, a cool change, and perhaps you are too. You are forgiven and made new through the love of God in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Well, we're going to pick things up a little bit here to close the service today. A little country music for you today. All about starting over.
Well, the road.
So you know what? That was, are we so blessed with an amazing group of people? Love you all so very much. Wow. So today, you could go home and listen to the same news you heard last week about all the really crazy stuff that is going on in our world today. You could. You could go home and you could take a look at that news. Or you know what? You can start changing the world. You can go out there and move a little soil. You could go work at the food pantry. You could go see some neighbor kid who just looks like the neighbor kid who needs a visit from somebody. Let's change this world. Let's step into this fresh start right now. And you can do it right now as well because I see some faces we haven't seen for a while. Hannah, we look forward to hearing Hannah sing again someday soon. And I saw Tony, but Tony wanted to get the donuts, I guess. Where are you, Tony? Just let folks know that you're happy that they're here. Go now in peace, my friends. No, don't go in peace. Go and get out there and be the change in the world. Amen.
Awesome.